Welcome to the AAAS Brain Briefing on Optogenetics, Controlling the Brain with Light. I'm Erin Heath, Associate Director of Government Relations at the American Association for the Advancement of Science, or AAAS. AAAS is the world's largest general scientific society, and we're dedicated to the advancement of scientific knowledge for the good of society as a whole. This is the fifth year of this series, which is funded by the Dana Foundation. The Dana Foundation is a philanthropic organization that supports brain research through grants and educates the public about the successes and potential of brain research. We thank them for their support, and I'd like to give a special thanks to Executive Vice President of Communications, Barbara Rich. Special thanks also go to my colleagues, Bethany Spencer, Sean Gallagher, Sarah Spitzeria, and Lydia Caprellian for helping with this event, and to Congressman Chaka Fattah. Congressman Fattah has been a real champion of neuroscience research, and I'd like to welcome him up here now for opening remarks.
Well, let me thank our AAAS and the Dana Foundation. And this is going to be a real treat. And it's taken me a minute to gather myself. This has been, I spoke this morning to the New Markets Tax Credit Coalition. And then I met with the head of the Advanced Medical Technology Device Association. I just had a meeting with the ambassador from Israel to talk about the Iran negotiations around the nuclear agreement. So I can assure you, right, that I'm ready for this briefing on optogenetics, because this is this superior to all other things that are equal. This is the most important thing that I'm engaged in, which is neuroscience. And I have visited with a number of the universities in which you're going to hear from experts from. I went out to MIT. Because I wanted to learn more about what was going on in terms of this almost, breakthrough area of research. And it's fascinating because the UN has announced that this is the year of the light, right? Looking at major advancements in light-related research and science. And one of the areas that they focused on is the subject matter of today's briefing. And at MIT, I learned so much. I then went on out to Stanford, spent some time there, and then to New York. So you're going to be able, without having to travel anywhere, from Dr. Boyden and Dr. Chow from University of Pennsylvania, thank you, Dr. Lin, who by way of Duke, is now in NYU, you're going to hear about how science has illuminated the use of light in understanding the circuits and the activities of the human brain. And this is clearly a major breakthrough that's going to lead to and has already led to a host of new approaches at some of the challenges related to the human brain. So I want to thank AAAS and the Dana Foundation. And I got introduced right when I was going to take a bite out of my sandwich. I'm going to rejoin my sandwich now and listen to our experts. Thank you.
Thank you, Congressman. We have a fantastic panel today. I'm going to turn it over now to Dr. Edward Boyden, who leads the MIT Media Lab Synthetic Neurobiology Group and co-directs the MIT Center for Neurobiological Engineering. You'll find his bio and the bios for all of our speakers in your programs. Ed.
So I'd like to thank the AAAS and thank you, thank the Congressman as well for his kind introduction. So I think we might begin with a little bit of context. Why are we here, and what is the big problem we're trying to solve? And part of the problem is that the brain is incredibly complicated. So within a cubic millimeter of your brain or my brain, you would find something like 100,000 of these tiny cells called neurons. And these neurons are incredibly complicated. They're connected by very fine wires, and they compute at insanely high speeds. So within that cubic millimeter of brain tissue, These cells are undergoing little electrical pulses, and they're exchanging chemicals. And something like a significant fraction of a trillion events per second is happening in that tiny cubic millimeter of your brain. And yet somehow, this is mediating our thoughts and feelings and actions, and the density and speed require new tools if we want to address how these things work. Now, the high speed of operation of the brain, you know, makes it really beg the comparison to a computer. And there are some similarities and some differences. Computers, of course, are two-dimensional chips. They have on the order of a billion transistors. And some people like to say that a human brain has 100 billion neurons and tries to make an equivalency between them. But a single neuron has something like 10,000 connections with other neurons. And each of those connections is incredibly complicated. They're made of molecules that are all packed together. You know, and so the incredible complexity of computing really is far much bigger in a brain than in a computer. Now, brain science, of course, is very important because it can tell us something about the human condition. But brain disorders are incredibly daunting. And so these numbers are actually a little bit old. I think the picture is a little bit more dismal now. But if you look at brain drugs, the time that it takes to get out of the lab and into the market is almost a decade. The failure rate of a brain drug is very, very high, over 90%, to get clinical approval. And the cost is enormous. I think some more recent numbers suggest that it can be even in the multi-billion dollars per drug. And if you look at the number of people around the world who have some kind of brain disorder, whether it's schizophrenia or Alzheimer's or Parkinson's or epilepsy or addiction and so on, the numbers are very, very large, perhaps over a billion people. And as other diseases are incurred with inroads of scientific progress and coupled to an aging population in many countries, this number is growing larger. In fact, there have been analyses suggesting that diseases like Alzheimer's and so on could present major crises in many nations. So how do we make this a solvable problem? Well, the first thing we have to do is to understand more about the brain, both how to map it and how to repair it. We don't know how many kinds of cells there are in the brain. There are many different shapes and sizes. There are some that are large, some that are small, and they change in different ways in different disease states. We don't know how they're connected, how information flows in the brain. So if we want to really solve this, we have to build new tools. And you could argue that there's sort of the need for new tools to drive the science, sort of a yin and a yang here, and from the science you can drive new treatments, but you need both. If you just try to develop new treatments without knowing how the brain works, that's a bit just sort of random and leads to the low success rates that I told you about earlier. And if we don't, of course, have this sort of, you know, closed loop of innovation, it becomes really hard to get this process to converge. So the topic of today is optogenetics, and opto, of course, is for light, and genetics is because we need a way to convert light into electrical signals. And that's done by a genetically encoded reagent. We put the genetically encoded reagent into the neurons, and then if you shine light on the neuron, you can convert that light into electricity, basically. And as we talked about earlier, neurons compute using electricity, so if you can aim light at a cell, you could turn it on or off. If you could turn on a set of neurons, you could figure out what kinds of behaviors or pathological states it could drive. If you turn a neuron off or a set of neurons off, you could figure out what kinds of behaviors or pathological states that it's required for. And then, of course, you need a way of getting light into the brain. The brain doesn't feel pain, and so you can insert optical fibers, much like the kind that make up large chunks of the internet, into the brain. And so hundreds of groups around the world are using optogenetics in animal models, and an increasing number of companies are exploring optogenetics for therapeutics. So what is optogenetics, really? Well, it turns out that all over the tree of life, you can find molecules that convert light into electrical signals. In some organisms, they serve a photosynthetic role, but in some organisms, like this single-celled plant and a green algae, it serves a photosensory role. So we're about to zoom in onto a small organelle within this single-celled green alga, and when you do that, you'll see that there are small molecules that absorb light and undergo a series of transformations that let charged particles, ions, into this little organelle inside the cell. And this little green algae actually uses these light-driven signals to navigate, to steer around in water in order to photosynthesize better. Now, it turns out that this molecule has some really interesting properties. It has very fast responses, and it lets charged particles, ions, through that are exactly the same kind that activate neurons in the brain when you or I are communicating, like right now. Another piece of luck was that this molecule is genetically encoded. It's encoded for by a relatively small piece of DNA, small enough that you can transplant it easily using modern gene therapy techniques into a neuron. And serendipitously, when we actually put this gene into neurons about a decade ago, neurons were able to manufacture this protein, install it in the membranes of neurons, which is right where you want to be if you want to exchange electrical charge from the environment into the neuron. And then, if you shine light on the cell, these molecules were able to function. They were able to respond with the right speed and amplitude of effect to cause the very same kinds of electrical pulses that neurons use when they're computing or communicating. So how do you use this tool? Well, as I mentioned earlier, we don't have a complete parts list of the brain yet, but we do know some of the major cell types of the brain, and lots of efforts are ongoing to try to map the brain and to get the list of cell types. So for example, there are some cell types in the brain that are inhibitory neurons. They are small star-shaped cells called basket cells. And these are interesting because they are involved with a lot of different interesting neural computations, and also they're amongst the neurons that are atrophied in patients with schizophrenia. So we can use tricks from gene therapy to target this light-activated molecule just to those neurons, and then if you deliver light to the brain, those neurons will be turned on. And so you can imagine trying to activate these in a schizophrenia model, in an animal, for example, and trying to figure out if you jazz up the activity of these neurons, can you repair the cognitive deficits? And as you'll see at the end, maybe there's even ways to use this potentially as a therapeutic in humans. So many people are doing interesting things with optogenetics. I'll just show one quick example. A lot of people are interested in the cells in the brain that are important for learning or for addiction, which if you think about it, is sort of learning gone wrong. And so this is some work done by the Fiorillo group, where they wanted to figure out whether small sets of neurons deep in the brain that manufacture a transmitter called dopamine are involved directly with this process. And many of us have heard of dopamine. It's often referred to as the pleasure center of the brain or through other similar kinds of references. But they're enormously complicated cells that are involved with a wide variety of normal and pathological processes. So what Chris Fiorillo designed was a very simple task where mice could go to one point in a box and poke its nose into a little sensor and earn a pulse of light down an optical fiber from a laser into the brain. Or a mouse could go to another point in a box and nothing would happen. And so as you can see in this movie, the mouse will go to a little sensor, poke its nose, get a pulse of light from the laser down the optical fiber, and it's driving reinforcement. It's making the brain do more of what it was just doing. And so this allowed them to prove, really, that single brief activations of this set of cells was able to reinforce the behavior of the brain. Now, there's all sorts of other molecules that you can find that have interesting properties. And as I mentioned, in addition to photosensation, there are some molecules that serve energy harvesting roles, almost like a primitive form of photosynthesis. And so you can take these molecules that have this property and put them into neurons, and it turns out that what they do is to actually do the opposite of the activation. Instead of bringing one kind of ion, the positive charge ions, into the neuron, which activates them, they do the opposite. They bring negative charge ions into the cell or bring positive charges out. And so if you put these molecules into neurons, what will happen when you shine light is that they'll be turned off. And so you can imagine, and there are groups doing experiments like this, that if you put these molecules in to the brain of, let's say, an epileptic brain, and again, these are again beginning with mouse models, they're not at the human stage yet, you could shine light and turn off a seizure. And so there are groups that have shown that you can take these molecules and put them in and shut down the activity of neurons and blockade seizures. So this is just one example here from the Yamanaka lab, which is sort of an example of what you can do scientifically that still informs medicine. And so at the top here, these are transgenic mice, mice whose genomes have been engineered to have this inhibitory molecule in them. And then an optical fiber is again aimed at this very tiny set of cells deep in the brain. These cells happen to be the hypercretin or orexin neurons. These are the neurons that atrophy or die off in patients with narcolepsy. And so they fall asleep at inopportune times. And at the bottom, you can see what happens when you actually deliver light to these neurons. On the y-axis is the vertical axis, is the probability of being awake. And you can see that these animals start out kind of awake, and then you turn the light on from the laser down the optical fiber to hit these cells, and bam, they're all passed out within about half a minute. And then when you turn the light off, they wake back up. And so this allows you to really prove that the deletion of activity, even for a brief amount of time, like half a minute, is causally involved with a pathological process like narcolepsy. And so now that you've pinpointed the point in a circuit that causes a disorder or that could be linked to the phenotype of a disorder, you can start to really try to map out the circuits that are connected to it and understand which might be therapeutic targets. So both basic science and clinically relevant investigations can be done in animal models, but a very exciting other direction is whether these could be used in humans directly. And over the last several years, there's been a lot of excitement about neuromodulation. In fact, something like, well, this number is out of date, it might be up to over 300,000 people so far, have had some kind of neural stimulator implanted in their nervous system, either cochlear implants for deafness or neural implants in the central nervous system for movement disorders like Parkinson's disease. And so this is very exciting because it means that you can target energy, in this case electrical energy, to points in the brain to help fix problems. And so if electrical energy, why not optical energy? And so we and others have started to build optical implants, even wirelessly controlled and powered ones, that let you deliver light into brain circuits. The other thing, of course, is you need a gene therapy. You have to get these genes into cells. And that's a little bit more tricky. In fact, I don't think there's a single FDA-approved gene therapy currently. But about a year ago, there was a lot of excitement because a gene therapy was approved in Europe for a relatively rare disorder. And so there's a bit of excitement that's occurring about the potential for gene therapy. So one interesting target, and there's actually multiple companies that are going after this, is whether you could try to treat blindness. Millions of patients have forms of blindness where the photoreceptor cells, which are on top of the clock here, have ablated or been killed off or die. And these patients are blind. And because those cells are dead, it's very difficult to treat these conditions. And let's zoom in to the back of the eye just to take a quick look at that. The photoreceptor cells are at the top. They capture light and transmit information to further down the road until you finally get to the brain, which is where these nerves go. And in these patients, the photoreceptor cells are gone. But light can still get in. And so the idea is, why can't you take these light-sensitive molecules and install them? And that creates a virtual camera. So what you're going to see here is a blind mouse trying to solve a maze. And the maze is a water maze, because mice like to swim, but they'd rather sit and do nothing. And there are six arms to the maze. This is a blind mouse. That's what that acronym means, indicating a mutation. And the mouse is swimming around, and mice are smart, so they eventually find their way out, but they're not using vision to do it. And so this mouse was blind about 8 weeks beforehand, and now it can dead reckon directly to the target, and it can find the target as fast as a wild-type mice can. So it doesn't prove that they can see vision, you know, the way that a normal eye does, but it does show that the mice can make cognitive use of their visual information, and so that's one of the data sets that has motivated the inquiry into whether this could be used as a real therapy for blindness. The other thing I mentioned towards the end was, well, how do we map the brain? We kind of have this interesting state now where we can control the brain really well, but how do we control it? There's so many sites in the brain, so many neurons. And so what we really want to do is to map the brain, ideally as much as possible, with nanoscale precision. Now, there are lots of people trying to do that, but it's difficult. You know, last year, actually, a couple of the inventors of so-called super-resolution imaging won the Nobel Prize in chemistry. But these methods are very, very slow and expensive compared to, you know, the desired rates of brain mapping. And so, as I mentioned, we've been taking polymers that are a lot like the polymers in baby diapers, sodium polyacrylate, and these polymers have interesting properties. When you add water, they swell and become bigger. And so we can take brain tissues, embed them in these dense polymers, add water, and we can actually make the brain tissue bigger. And so these polymers are very, very dense. The mesh size, the spacing, is just a few nanometers. So we think we're pushing all the molecules apart from each other, is one hypothesis. So, and this is the final, I included a still image just in case. Here's a brain circuit that's very, very significant in size. It's got 30 billion voxels or pixels, and it's got neurons and connections, and you can zoom all the way into parts of neurons, and then finally all the way down to a single neural connection. And so now, for the first time really, we can image large intact 3D tissues, but with the nanoscale precision that we need in order to do brain mapping. So in patients who've lost these photoreceptors, you might ask, well, what can you do? And so one idea is, well, these light-activated molecules that we found, could we install them in other cells of the eye, like some of these deeper layers that are still alive, and convert them into a virtual camera? You've lost the initial light-capturing cells, but could you install them in remaining cells and allow the actual conversion of the non-seeing eye into a camera. And so there are at least three companies that are pursuing this and trying to figure out whether you could actually do this and restore vision to potentially, in the long run, millions of patients who have lost their sight. So a big question then is, well, what next? And you're going to hear two more talks about the future and existing developments in optogenetics, as well as some very cool applications. But there's a lot to be done still. And so optogenetics was one of the technologies that spurred excitement for the Brain Initiative, which of course is driving technologies that can hopefully help a lot of basic neuroscience, as well as clinical insights and treatments in patients. And so we and many other groups are engaged with a wide variety of tasks trying to figure out, can we record the dynamical activity of the brain? Can we develop robots to help process and analyze brain tissues in a high throughput way? And recently, our group developed a method to try to map the brain with nanoscale precision. The way we do it is you take a piece of brain tissue, and instead of using a lens to take a picture, we physically blow it up. We physically make it bigger. And the way we do it is we take a piece of brain tissue, embed it in a really dense material that's made up of the same material as baby diapers, basically. And then when you add water, the baby diaper material will swell and take the brain tissue with it. So for the first time, you can really map large 3D objects with nanoscale precision. And so we're very excited about the possibility then of actually being able to image a very, very large variety of tissues and circuits and so forth. So I guess I can close on a note that this is all a very omnidisciplinary kind of endeavor. You know, to make optogenetics work required optical insights, you know, molecular insights, and a wide variety of other disciplines to come to bear. And so we're very excited about bringing more engineers into these interesting neuroscience areas, as well as to help neuroscientists, both basic and clinical, to use these tools to gain insight into their clinical scenarios and potentially to create treatments as well. So, thank you.
Thanks so much. Now for our second speaker, Dr. Dayu Lin, Assistant Professor of the Departments of Psychiatry and Neuroscience at the NYU Langone Medical Center.
Hello, everybody. I would like to join Boyden, Dr. Boyden, to thank AAAS for giving me this opportunity to share my research with you. So Dr. Boyden and Dr. Chow are the tool makers, and I am the tool users. So I'm going to tell you a story about how we use optogenetics and other tools trying to understand the neural mechanism underlining aggressive motivation. So aggressive motivation, aggression, that's something we observe across the animal kingdoms, from the insects we observe here to the primates and to humans. Aggression is a very important mean to help us to compete for limited resources. But sometimes aggression can get a little bit tricky. So for humans, there are two types of aggression I could think of, and in the literature that has been postulated. One is called the reactive aggression. So that kind of aggression does not rely on the immediate cues being there. One big example is like a road rage, right? And for example, if I'm in a bar, you say something insulting and I punch you on the face, that's reactive aggression. And the other kind of aggression is a little bit more thoughtful. That is, we call it a proactive aggression. It does not depend on immediate cues. So what that is, if I'm at home thinking about how much I hate you, and I drive my car to your house, and then punch you on the face. So that is a proactive aggression. So the major difference between this reactive aggression and a proactive aggression is this seeking phase. Seeking phase. So in my lab, one of the directions we're trying to understand is what is the neural mechanisms underlying this seeking phase of aggression. So how are we going to approach that? Well, we use an animal that is a little bit more manageable than a road rage. That is mouse. So maybe in contrast to this cuddling image of the mouse, mice are actually quite aggressive. If you put a strange male into the home of another male, they're not going to have a friendly conversation about girls next door or footballs. Instead, they're going to fight with each other. If they're not separated within a couple hours, one will be heavily wounded. So there is no lack of aggression in the mice, but where the mice seek the opportunity to attack. How can we ask the mice, do you want to attack or not? So in order to address this question, we designed an experimental operant task so that we can communicate with the animals. So what we do is basically, this is the home cage of the animal, and we introduce a panel with two pokers in it. So animals, mice, they're very curious animals, so they will poke around and see what happens. And when they poke one of the designated poker, which we call it a social poker, then after a short period of time, we'll introduce a weak intruder, a male intruder. So this is a male right here. It's all males, okay? And then after a short interaction period, which is 10 seconds, we remove this intruder, and then they can go back and poke again. If they poke the other poker, nothing happened. It's just a control, a no non-poker. So that poker doesn't elicit any consequences. And this is the behavior in action, just to show you a little bit what's happening here. And this is the mouse, a very well-trained mouse. And this is the two pokers. And the outside one is the active poker. And he poked it. And we introduce a little intruder here. And not so friendly interaction for about 5-10 seconds. And then we remove the mouse, and you can see the mouse is highly agitated, move around, and then quickly, he goes to poke again. And the mouse is being introduced again, a different mouse. And then we remove the animal again. And in about 10 seconds. He went back and poke again. So what we found is that in about half of the animals we went through this training paradigm, they can learn this task readily. So you can see that the poking rate for this social poke will increase over the days of training, while the poking rate for the no poker stays the same. And in another half of the mice, they don't learn the task. It's not because they don't know how to fight, or they are dumb, or they are physically incapable. They actually quite as intelligent as the other mice in other kind of a task we put them through, but they don't want to engage in this kind of a task. And we want to see what's the difference between them. And one major thing we want to measure is, are they different in the aggression levels? So to test the aggression level of the animals, we just employ a very classic test, which is called the resident intruder test. In this task, simply a male mouse is putting the mouse of a testing mouse for 10 minutes, and we counted the number of attacks that occurred between this pair of animals. And we found that in our cohort of the animals, there is a natural split of the aggressive and high aggression and the low aggression animals. And we found that the learning capacity is closely related to the aggressiveness of the animals. The more aggressive animals, they tend to be better learners in this task, suggesting that part of the motivation for learning the task is aggression related. And the other thing we want to ask is the animal just want to be able to fight? Or they want to have a social companion? Or the motivation for learning this task is actually dominant, or winning the task. So to test this hypothesis, we have this called intruder replacement test. So basically what we do is in the animals that's already well-trained aggression seekers, we call them, and we will replace them, secretly sneak out the intruder. Instead of putting a weak, wimpy intruder, we put in their equal part. So a big male who is as strong as they are, sexually experienced, singly housed for 3 days. And then we switch back to this weaker intruders, briefly. And here is what happened. And what you see is that when animal is given the submissive intruders, each line indicates a poke. The blue is to the social port, and the red is to the no port. We find that every time When it encounters the submissive intruders, the poke rate is fairly high. But when we replace it to a non-submissive intruder, quickly the poke rate drops. And this poke rate can be recovered when we go back to this submissive intruders. And we see this, is one example animals, and we see this in many of the animals tested, except one, which goes back. Basically, this mouse is the absolute alpha mice. It realizes it can beat up anybody. It doesn't care. So he picked up his poking rate right away. All right. So now we know that aggressive male mice, they will seek out the opportunity to attack. Then the next question is, what is the neural substrate mediating this aggressive seeking behavior? Probably in the brain, there are many regions involving this complex task. But there is one particular region we are very interested in. And that region is deep down in the brain, in everybody's brain. It's called the ventrolateral part of the ventral median hypothalamus. I would say it probably 10,000 times now. So why this region we're interested? Because our previous studies have shown that this region is very essential for the attacking behaviors in the mice. And thanks to the beautiful tools Dr. Boyden and Dr. Chow developed. So one key experiment is that we virally express this small molecule that Dr. Boyden borrowed from the algae called the chondrodopsin into this area. And we put an optic fiber right on top of it. So now virtually we have a light switch in the brain. We can just turn on this group of cells and activate them and see what happened. And here is a little video showing you what happened here. And I will give you some signs and LED light showing you when the light is being passed to this little area. And this is a brown upper glove, okay? So now the light gets turned on. You can see this animal start to charge this glove, which I never observe in natural conditions. So typically, when I take out the glove, you'll see the glove got punctuated. It will attack other conspecific as well, male, female. Glove is in the idea of mimicking hands, but I kind of don't want to put my hands there. So VMHVO is essential for attack. The question remains, is VMHVO also involved in the aggression-seeking behavior? So to address this question, first thing we do is trying to eardrop what's happening in the brain. To do that, we use electrophysiology. So electrophysiology, we implant 13 micrometer tungsten microwires in a tiny bundle, lower it in the VMHVL, and this tiny bundle of wires is gonna to pick up the spiking activities of individual cells. So that allows us to understand whether the cells is actually naturally involved in this process. And this is a spike twin, which neuroscientists like to see it. And each little line here indicating a spike, basically a sound, a signal that the cell is making, saying that I'm active. Okay. So here is one example cell here. And just let me orient you. On the top, we call it a raster plots. And each little tick here indicates one spike. And all this is aligned to the poke trials at the zero time point is when the poke actually occurred. And the red tick here indicates when the male comes in. And this is from one session, about 35 minutes. And during this, for this particular cell, you see that there's not much happening during this, we call it a poking phase, or we call it aggression seeking phase. But there is a lot of activity going on when the male comes in. So this cell is engaged in this male-male interaction, but not so much in the seeking phase of aggression. But that's not the whole story. We find a variety of cell types in this area. And for this particular cell, for example, it's active not only when the male comes in, but active before the poking occurred. And this cell is active right at the time of a poking. And this cell is active at the poking and then sustained its activity when animal is waiting for the other intruders to come in. So long story short, we found that there are 38% of the cells that will become active during the aggressive interaction, and 14% will become active during the poking. But what's important is that there is 11% of the cells that's actually active during both. So imagine there's a bunch of cells who will be firing when animal is encountering another male and fighting for it. Those cells, a subset of them, already become active when the animal is planning and thinking about this aggression events in the future. So now we know that those VMHVO cells are naturally involved in this aggression-seeking behavior, So the next question is those activity functionally relevant? So to address this question, we turn to our favorite tool, which is optogenetic, and trying to see whether we can bias the performance of the animals. So just a quickly reminder what we do here. What we do is we have the animal have a poker here, and the animal is alone in the cage, and they poke left or poke right. Once they poke one of the pokers, we'll give an intruder for intact for 10 seconds, okay? So in this particular paradigm, we're not stimulating when the animal is encountering the intruder. Rather, we're stimulating when the animal is alone in the cage. The question that we're trying to address is whether stimulation during that period of time will promote the animal to go aggression-seeking faster. Would they go poker with a shorter latency? So this is, again, a mouse in action. Oh, one thing is that we reset the trial after 10 minutes. If the animal doesn't poke for 10 minutes, then we turn on or turn off, we switch the stimulation type, okay? So this particular animal, hopefully it will play, is quite a relaxed tap. It doesn't poke very intensively all the time. In fact, it didn't poke for a whole 10 minutes. And it was just sitting there and doing its resting and playing around, messing around. But when we turn on the stimulation, the animal quickly directed its attention to this poker and start to poke on the poke. Okay, right, had to play. So this is sped up by 20 times just because otherwise you will be here for a while. So now we turn on the stimulation. Animal quickly moved and start to poke. So, and we introduce the intruder. Okay. So this is a very reproducible results. This is from one single session here. Well, what I'm showing you here is a latency to the poke on individual trials. And we interleave the sham trials with the stimulation trials. And you can see the blue dots, which are the stimulation trials, are all lining low. That's because the latency to poke upon stimulation is always short. While the sham trials, the latency is quite variable, with some long and some short, which is expected. And this is highly reproducible, not only within session, but across days, and also across animals. This is showing the performance of 8 animals on 3 repeated days. Can see that the stimulation always promoting this poking performance. Okay, so to conclude today's talk, my talk, what I showed you is aggression, VMHVO, is an essential region, not only for attack, but also for aggression-seeking behavior. And this region, we have reason to believe it's quite conserved across the animal kingdoms. This tiny region, if you stimulate electrically in primates, it will cause threatening vocalization. In the human patients with the tumors in the posterior hypothalamus will have a hyperaggression phenotype. And we think that many, many of our society problems come from those aggression-seeking behavior. We hope that by understanding what is the neural mechanism of aggression-seeking, we'll find a proper ways to channel it and suppress it. Okay, thank you very much for your attention. I want to give a special shout out to this extremely talented postdoc, Anna Greta Faulkner, who is single-handed performed all the experiments I talk about today. Thank you.
Thank you. Our final speaker is Dr. Brian Chow. He's Assistant Professor of Bioengineering at the University of Pennsylvania. Brian.
Okay, I want to again thank the organizers for inviting me to speak, and also the other panelists. We see each other a lot at these meetings like this, and it never ceases to amaze me how quickly their work progresses and what type of amazing things that they're doing in their labs. So today what I'm going to be talking about are developing optogenetic input and output interfaces to the brain. My lab is largely a technology development lab. And why are you motivated by this? Developing new inputs and outputs in the brain. And this is reiterating what you've heard from the previous two talks. But we've known since the time of Ramon and Call and Wernicke and Broca that the brain is hierarchically organized, right? You get a lesion to a specific brain region, you get an abnormal speech or language processing pathology, and we can associate that with, say, a computational center for the brain. For that specific, say, task or mood or so on and so forth. And through years of tremendous work in neurobiology, we've reduced this view of the brain to a finer granularity but still tractable description in terms of kind of circuits of dynamically interacting cell types. So just like we have different cell types in our body, heart, lung, immune cells, within your brain you may have 1,000, 10,000 different cell types that are wired in these kind of pseudotype ways, that, like, for example, this cortical microcircuit, the net activity of this would give rise to something like this, would be gamma oscillations in the brain. So these would be like the brain waves you would see if you were to get an EEG. This is hypothesized to, say, be the pacemaker or clock for the brain for, say, executive function, cognitive function. And so sometimes you see these types of kind of network activity compromised in patients with cognitive disorders like schizophrenia or autism spectrum disorders. But if we zoom in even further within a single neuron or neuron cell type, we still have incredibly complex circuitry. Intracellular signaling circuits. This is actually just one type of circuit. This is actually GPCR signaling pathways that really take external stimuli and couple that to transcriptional events downstream. So taking kind of external stimulus to kind of genetic regulation. And you can see how incredibly complex this is. And the kind of subtle nuances between all these signaling pathways and the components of them is very, very important. Because at the end of the day, this is, if we're going to make pharmacological agents and drugs, this is what we're drugging. We're drugging a protein. And so what my lab is largely focused on is developing the toolkit so that we can kind of perturb and monitor individual cell types with the kind of spatial temporal precision and timescale that the brain computes, but in a naturalistic way that implicates a very specific signaling pathway or protein, which has led us to optogenetics, and many years led me to Ed's lab as a postdoc. And as Ed pointed out, we have very powerful tools to control transmembrane potential, the voltage across neurons, plasma membranes, that we can then use to turn on or off neural activity by controlling their electrical activity. But I think one thing that's really fascinating about optogenetics is biochemical diversity that can be reached. So, for example, there's a lot of existing photoreceptors and tools that we can create to control a lot of different phenomena beyond electrogenic activity, beyond electrical activity. Again, GPCR signaling pathways, and I focus on GPCRs a lot, as someone who used to be in neuroscience drug discovery, GPCRs and their associated pathways are kind of the targets of 50% of FDA-approved drugs. Transcription factors, that are regulating gene expression, so on and so forth. And this is even more rapidly expanding into, say, arbitrary functions. So we can take natural photoreceptors and components of them that are just the sensor domains and combine them with other proteins to kind of essentially develop photoactive variants of kind of any protein that we want. And we can kind of invert the problem on its head and create genetically encoded reagents that can report physiological events instead of just perturb them. And so if you think about this rapidly expanding biochemical toolbox, it potentially one day offers a very interesting possibility, something that I'll call virtual pharmacology. So if you think about the nature of the way the brain is organized, right, it's built up from molecules and genes all the way to circuits and whole organisms and their associated behaviors. And how do we interface the nervous system at these various levels of biological integration? Well, we can create molecules, gene therapies, drugs, so on and so forth, at a very small scale. And we can, if we're perturbing large circuits or whole organisms, we have, say, behavior cognitive therapy, electrical stimulation, so on and so forth. And optogenetics is really well suited for this kind of microcircuit view of the world. But what I find really fascinating is this possibility that if we think about what kind of industries and general approaches there are to these interfaces, this is sort of the state space we associate with drugs, right, of pharma. Right? And this is sort of the state space we associate with medical devices. And this, right, this device-based approach is extremely fast and highly precise in terms of spatial resolution. But we don't really know what it does. We can pump current into the brain, and we can kind of shut it down, but we can't just say, I want to somatically hyperpolarize this cell type. Right? That's a level of biochemical specificity that's just not available right now with devices. Conversely, we can take drugs, and they could be extremely precise. We know what target they're hitting, we know what the KD of that interaction is, so on and so forth. But by design, drugs are slow, right? With the exception of, say, procedural anesthetics, right? You're meant to take drugs as seldom as often. So if a drug is once a day, in the grand scheme of things, for pharmacokinetic reasons, right, the temporal resolution is a day, right? That's a lot longer than the millisecond time scale that the brain computes at. And so optogenetics is really fascinating to me because it gives you this biochemical precision of a drug, or a gene therapy, but at the spatiotemporal resolution of a device. And so how is it that we go about trying to expand this biochemical state space? And this is very similar to something Ed had pointed out, but Mother Nature has been engineering photoreceptors for 3.5 billion years and has given us a lot of different new functions and has given us a lot of kind of structural prototypes to deal with. Okay, and these are all kind of crystal structures of say, known classes of photoreceptors. Right? And so if you think about from a discovery and engineering perspective, the approach is not all that dissimilar to, say, what a medicinal chemist does, or a natural product chemist does, where they kind of fish molecules out of organisms and have managed to make incredible oncology drugs, immunosuppressants, antibiotics, so on and so forth. Well, we spend a lot of time looking at what's the functional diversity of natural photoreceptors discovered through next generation sequencing and trying to use that information to discover new tools. What are these types of tools that we want to create or kind of, you know, what are we trying to optimize around? So early on, this is work that I did as a postdoc in Ed's lab, you know, we were very focused on high performance tools. So for example, a tool like ARCH that we collaboratively discovered, where you can express this in neurons and shine light on it. And this is a kind of a electrophysiological recording, not all too dissimilar from, say, heart rate monitoring and so on and so forth, where these would be electrical activity that you record as a result of action potentials when you shine light. You can see the activity is completely lesioned over a pretty large range of timescales as possible. This is data actually from a mouse. But interestingly, if we take variants of this tool, ARCH, we can actually inhibit, say, median silencing efficiency of, say, greater than 99% of activity in a non-human primate, so a very large animal, and really as close as you can get to the humans without actually being in humans. Another axis we think about is just functional diversity. Again, I mentioned we're very interested in biochemical diversity. And so, for example, this is a summary of the functions of roughly about 8,000 photoreceptors of a class of photoreceptors called LOV domains. And we and a large consortium of researchers led by Gain Wong at the University of Alberta recently sequenced about 1,000 plant and algae transcriptomes. And through that, actually discovered about 6,000 of these LOV domains, so quadrupling the known diversity. And what's important about that is not necessarily the number, but what we found, right? There are potentially new functions, for example, natural photoreceptors that we could use to control lipid signaling events, right? Or natural photoreceptors that we can use to inhibit GPCR signaling pathways, for example, like light-activated RGS proteins. But another axis that we're thinking about is color, right? And expanding the color palette. And why would we want to expand the color palette? Well, if we look at the brain, there's so many different cell types that you really want to be able to do is turn one cell type on or off, independent of another, and do it kind of in the same intact circuit. So again, in work published with Ed's lab, we discovered, say, it's different spectral variants that would, say, absorb yellow or orange or red light better than they would absorb, say, blue light. And so we can express one tool on one neuron and another tool on another neuron and selectively inhibit the spiking activity of one neuron in response to red light and then a different neuron in response to blue light. Conversely, again, using next-gen sequencing technologies to identify new channel rhodopsins from diverse algae, we can do the same, right? We can find different channel rhodopsins to turn on neurons instead of off neurons with two different colors of light. And so we've recently become really interested in pushing the boundaries of wavelength that these proteins absorb light. At the end of the day, light is just a form of electromagnetic radiation. And radiation tends to exhibit this phenomena that short wavelengths are high energy. It doesn't penetrate materials very well. It either gets absorbed or scattered, right? So it doesn't pass through materials well. One way to easily think about it is if you go into your basement, you can probably pick up an AM radio signal, but not, say, a cell phone signal. And that's really largely a byproduct of kind of wavelength and how easily different wavelengths penetrate, say, concrete versus others. And so long wavelengths, short energy material, can kind of penetrate materials or pass through materials far more easily. And so in a biomedical context, you know, at very short wavelengths, like x-rays, for example, we can get crystal structures. Say in the visible and in near IR, we may utilize those wavelengths for things like photodynamic therapy or LASIK surgery. We may use optical wavelengths for fluorescence microscopy. But if we really want to interact with large circuits, large volumes of tissue, whole organisms going through bones, so on and so forth, we really want to be in this range, sort of in the red and beyond, right? And so these are sort of the wavelengths associated with things like ultrasound imaging or MRI imaging, right? They're low energy, but they give us large volumes. Okay? And so what's one example of engineering optimizing for pushing wavelength out as far as we can? And so we noticed years ago that the wavelength at which these photoreceptors absorb light and harvest that light is really dependent on what organisms they come from. And so if we find specific organisms that really absorb red light quite well and kind of screen all of those organisms from that genus, we can find really redshifted reagents. And so we managed through discovering kind of a new protein scaffold, so to speak, and optimizing them through some techniques in terms of controlling how they traffic in a cell when they're overexpressed, and also utilizing crystal structures to kind of augment their photocurrent that they can generate, managed to collaboratively create a tool where we can actually shut down spiking activity several millimeters deep in the brain, but instead of having the fiber implanted through the brain, we actually have diffuse light being projected onto the brain going through the skull, right? And so you can actually see that here where, again, we can lesion the activity in response to externally delivered red light, and this is a raster plot not too dissimilar from what you just previously saw. And again, we can lesion the activity with very high efficiency, right? So if you think about implementation, right, and technological limits, right? Part of the limit is how much light can you get into this tissue. Part of the limit is how much tissue can you label with your transgene that photosensitizes the brain. And what it comes down to is that if we can go several millimeters through 7 millimeters of tissue with very dim light, that's already saturated. It's already much larger than the amount of tissue we can label with a virus used in gene therapy. So what it means is kind of, at least for inhibition, pushing wavelength further out or kind of trying to make better ways to shut down the brain sort of has diminishing returns. Nothing's ever solved, but there's sort of diminishing returns, right? So in one way is the limiting factor, of one of the two limiting factors is largely overcome. Another example of how this kind of high performance from redshift to reagents could be very useful is in retinal prosthetics for inherited blindnesses like RP. Ed alluded to this earlier. But RP is the most common form of inherited blindness. There are maybe 1 to 200 different mutations associated with it. But we really don't have any great treatments for high resolution vision restoration. So we can have implants, for example, that allow edge detection and know if a room is, so people aren't bumping into things, or to know if a room is bright or dark, but no one's going to be reading a newspaper with a electrical retinal implant because the resolution is insufficient. There may be several dozen or 100 or so electrodes in the eye. Right? If you think about the eye as a camera, right? Think about just the difference between like a cheap webcam versus like some 7 megapixel camera. Right? There's just a vast resolution difference. So one approach that is commonly employed is to control bipolar cells or ganglion cells. These are cells that are sort of the final steps between photoreceptors and your visual cortex. So these are basically the cells that write information back to your brain. But you could potentially hyperpolarize cone photoreceptors. So these would be a set of patients which perhaps are a different stage of disease progression or different mutations or different dystrophies associated with their condition. And that will then, if you inhibit this, actually the way the circuit is set up, it actually will stimulate bipolar on cells or ganglion cells. So by shutting these cells down, you can actually turn these cells on and send information back to the brain. And so this is work done out of Botan Roska's lab. And the short of it is that tools like JAWS, which was the redshifted reagent that I showed on the previous slide, can generate very high frequency spiking in the ganglion cells, the final cells that are between kind of your eye and the brain. And why is this important, right? We can support, say, mean firing of, say, 200 hertz or more. Again, if you just think about cameras, right? If you think about trying to compare something in the low tens of hertz, like an old tube TV, compared to, say, like a 240 hertz HD TV, right? There's just a tremendous difference in resolution just from that increased processing speed, right? The other reason is that if you look at cone photoreceptors, we may have millions of cone photoreceptors that are surviving in our patients. They just don't detect light anymore. And so again, the comparison being, imagine something where you only have like 10 pixels or 100 pixels versus a 7 megapixel camera, right? These patients want high resolution vision restoration, and this data doesn't necessarily show that a mouse can read or anything by any stretch of the imagination. It just shows through electrophysiological correlates that it may one day be possible. So to conclude, I just have one more slide after this. I want to talk about an opposite problem. So everything up until now, I've talked about kind of how do we perturb circuits? How do we have physiological inputs to the brain or the nervous system by utilizing tools that we discover by surveying natural diversity, right? Now I want to talk about the opposite problem. How do we get information out of the brain, right? How do we have physiological outputs? But instead of utilizing natural diversity, we're going to utilize rational design. And there's a specific reason for that I'll get into shortly. So why do we want information out of the brain, right? And how do we normally get information out of the brain? Well, if you think of what happens in the clinic, a lot of what we do historically has just been kind of verbal cues. Right? Ask a patient, how are you feeling today? Does this hurt? So on and so forth. Right? This is pretty non-quantitative and really limits our understanding of the brain, right? So if you think about verbal scales, is kind of the reliance on verbal scales is part of the reason we'll say that pain drugs are so hard to develop because it's a 1 to 10 scale, like someone asking you, how do you feel? We can utilize other physiological measures that are a little more precise, like EEG, or heart rate monitors, so on and so forth, or biochemical measures like analyzing blood, CSF, plasma, so on and so forth. But if, you know, with new technologies, we can get a lot more information out of the nervous system, whether it be through sequencing to get genetic information or functional imaging. So say it would be contrast enhanced, say MRI imaging, for example. And this, to me, is really exciting because it has the capability to kind of bring in all of these different measures, physiological measures, genetic measures, and biochemical measures, in that we can have engineer light-responsive or radiation-responsive proteins that we can utilize to tell us when a transcriptional event happens, right, when a protein is going to be expressed. Or we can couple it to something where the light output is modulated by some binding event, so it tells us through kind of the light output out of a protein that's bound to another protein, where that second protein binds to calcium, for example, we can get a measure of, say, calcium inside of a cell. And this, being a protein, if we make it optogenetically, is a gene that we can express in a specific cell type and get genetic information out. So why, I mentioned before that this last slide is really going to talk about rational design. And why rational design? So everything I talked about today, I said Mother Nature has given us a huge toolbox to deal with, to work with, for perturbing the brain, right? Namely photoreceptors that organisms use for sensory integration to guide decisions in, you know, phototaxis or circadian rhythms or so on and so forth. Mother Nature has not given us a lot of tools to get light out of systems, right? Has not given us a lot of tools for that output. And if you think about what's the nature of a photoreceptor, right? There's usually a cofactor, that's an antenna, that absorbs some type of radiation, and a protein around that, where upon absorbing radiation, that cofactor causes some change in the protein where you get some signaling change, right? The whole protein is designed to take that sensory input and convert that into a physical motion change that causes some signaling event, okay? So for example, if you take something like a rhodopsin, which is what we use in our eyes, to see, and similar structures are the basis of, let's say, channel rhodopsin, which I showed from the algae. This can actually emit infrared light, but very poor efficiency because it's not designed to do so. So what if we just try to flip the problem on its head, right? What if we just start with the antennas, the cofactors that Mother Nature has given us, but then completely just build an artificial protein around it to do exactly what we want it to do, so that it takes all that energy, right, that's coming into that cofactor, instead of turning into some structural rearrangement to lead to a signaling event, leads to something else that I want it to do. And so this is pretty new data, and I apologize for those of you who aren't used to looking at spectra and kinetic traces. This may look like something that like my 3-year-old drew, but you have to take my word for it. This is pretty exciting. So what we can do is make artificial infrared absorbing proteins, right, or infrared fluorescent proteins. So proteins that bind bilirubin chromophores that you can express in cells, and it will absorb infrared light and emit infrared light. Again, this is infrared being very important because we can penetrate deeper tissue depths. And then if we really think about pushing wavelength even further out into, say, microwave and radio, right, where we can now go through human skull and do whole body imaging, right? This is actually a variant of this, where we've actually made it what's called a T2 contrast agent. So these are MRI contrast agents, where instead of being something like GFP that fluoresces in a cell, now it changes the signal from water when we do MRI imaging. And so the way this works is you have an event called T2 relaxation, and this contrast agent shortens that T2 time and gives us kind of better imaging discrimination. So if any of you have had MRIs, and you may have had an IV where they give you gadolinium, it's the thing that kind of makes your tongue taste like metal when you're doing that imaging. This is a genetically encoded version of a T2 contrast agent. So as a summary, I think we've heard a lot about various different technology developments. We've talked about, say, algal, and a lot of different aspects of basic biology, from kind of algal phototaxis to kind of aggressive, the origin of aggressive behavior, and it can kind of be mind-numbing. But to think about, you know, how broad optogenetics really is in terms of its implications and what it draws from. But I think the take-home, if I can just say, you know, one parting thought, is that really what we're enabling here collectively as a community, you know, between our labs and the larger community, is just input-output interfaces in the brain, switchboards for the brain that we can say make different connections between different nodes and see how resultant behaviors changes, how different mood or cognitive states change. Alternatively, we can listen in to conversations between different nodes within this complex computer that's the brain and try to glean insight from that as well. So with that, I'd just like to thank my lab and collaborators, especially Ed, who we've had many years of great collaboration with, and also our funding sources. Thank you.
Thanks. And now we're going to bring all three speakers up to the panel table for a Q&A. Who has questions?
So far, everything, small things and big things, seems to expand about the same amount. So we can take a brain tissue and expand it in volume 100-fold, and the synapses also expand 100-fold. So the gap between the presynaptic and the postsynaptic side itself gets bigger by the same amount as the overall brain does. So we validated that down to around 60 nanometers or so, which should be enough to see single synapses. And we have now some work to try to validate down nearly the single molecule precision, although that's a lot of work. But you can imagine an era where we actually could move all the molecules of the brain away from each other, bring little barcodes that allow you to label each of them with a different virtual color, and you can read out the composition of the brain with molecular precision.
In 5 more years, if we're sitting here, what do you see in your crystal ball that optogenetics is going to do?
Hard to try to get these things into humans. But I think that it's interesting, the science is moving so fast, the mapping of the circuitry, as you've seen in mice and in other animals, that those insights are also driving interesting human applications. People are finding cell types that when you shut them down, you can, you know, quiet down seizures, for example. And then one idea is you could go in and find out what molecules are in those cells, and those become new drug targets, for example. So it's a wide variety of impacts that are happening on the medical side.
You're not going to go on a limb and forecast 5 years from now.
Oh, 5 years from now? Well, so the three companies that are pursuing the blindness translation, one of them has told me that if their current animal trials go successfully, they could try human trials of blindness within the next couple years. So, you know, again, the time to actually get approval for something is up to a decade or more. So 5 years is slow in clinical time, but fast in scientific time. So that's why it's a little hard to predict 5 years out.
Thank you.
powers of object technology is sort of the proliferative benefit of that technology, right? In the grand scheme of things, they're actually, you know, maybe a few dozen object tools, but they're some maybe questions that we've had for years and haven't been able to answer them because we didn't have the tools. Some being just new questions or new hypotheses that arise from some of the experimental data that comes about from being able to kind of control the brain with this type of cell type specificity. So one thing that's very exciting is the, you know, we kind of talked about this earlier, in many ways optogenetics, because the tools are utilized in so many labs, it's sort of almost a sourcing effort, right, which is a limited set of tools, but then the whole community utilizes it. It's really that kind of community-wide interaction and exploration that I think it is really where the value is. So will it give us anything fundamentally new that, you know, in the realm of neuroscience? To be determined, but we'll certainly get there much, much, much faster.
So I hope that in 5 years we will have see more labs working on aggression, actually. Mm-hmm. So aggression is a very fundamental question, but unfortunately it has been in the dark for neuroscience research in the last 3 decades, I would say. With all these amazing tools available right now, we really hope to see a revival of the field. And there is a lot to be learned in terms of what make us aggressive.
A quick question about federal involvement in your research, federal investment, and where areas, because we're having a big debate about spending priorities here in Washington, about if any of you wanted to share your thinking about whether we had any benefit from federal investment or the federal labs or, you know, interaction around your world that might be useful for us to know.
I think there's really two really important stories that are at the center of how these tools came to be. So one, of course, is that really basic curiosity about photosynthesis, about what makes algae swim, about what makes, you know, bacteria and other organisms photosynthesize decades ago. I mean, the first papers on these molecules came out around the early 1970s. You know, this very fundamental curiosity about the world later, decades later, yielded these transformational tools that are impacting neuroscience. So I think there's no substitute for, you know, just the good old-fashioned curiosity of the world, and the natural world in particular, as Brian was mentioning, is an incredible provider of resources for solving difficult medical problems. I think the second story is about the importance of innovation. And at least for our group, a lot of our funding is through non-traditional sources, including some government sources, like the NIH Director's Pioneer Award and other awards that are for high-risk, high-payoff research. And so, you know, if you can build a tool that could help solve 1,000 scientific questions, you know, how can you really find the levers that can steer the field forward? And that's very fun to think about, and it's useful to try to think about how to accelerate the entire biomedical enterprise.
So, I mean, we certainly benefit. I think all the labs in the field benefit, and it's necessary to have, you know, well, you know, a lot of federal funding to fund this kind of work. I do think there are certain gaps, some of which are largely addressed by the Brain Initiative, like neurotechnology development. Historically, technology development has not been necessarily well-funded because it's not necessarily hypothesis-driven, but I think there are kind of new funding mechanisms that really accelerate that. And then I will put in a kind of quirky pitch for say, increased funding to the NSF. And the reason for that is, if you think about all the federal agencies and sort of the dollars that get put in, the timelines that you're afforded, how forward-looking they are, NSF fits a very nice niche in terms of kind of very forward-looking problems with long timelines, but the dollar amounts for those awards are often kind of small. So all agencies need more funding. I'll make an eyeball pitch for increased funding.
I think the federal funding is absolutely essential for pushing the envelope of the research, in particular for particular directions.
think I'm really grateful that the re-recognition of the aggression field being very essential part of the neuroscience, which innovates the possibility of further research. So it has been actually for multiple decades that there is kind of untold dogma that aggression should not be funded, unfortunately. But now I think this is being removed, and then so we're really expecting a new wave of discoveries.
Awesome. Other hands.
Yep.
In the green and black.
I just had a question about, I kind of came here late, so I apologize about that, but if you guys are doing research when it comes to the brain wave and EEG readings, I know you've got a lot of new devices that are coming out for home use, even people to do brain mapping and also training of emotions, and also for
the first part of the question. So the complexity with brain waves and EEG is that it's the average, you know, or amalgamated activity of billions of neurons. And so it's very hard to extract information from it that's you know, that tells you what somebody, you know, is thinking or feeling and so on. It's very, very indirect information. That said, there are some clinical conditions like Parkinson's disease where you see certain brain waves and one can try then to disrupt them to, for example, cancel out Parkinsonian tremor. And so our group is in the process of actually, you know, looking at some clinical devices that could detect certain states and then perturb them, ideally non-invasively. So the tricky part with the, you know, sort of this access for non-invasive stuff is sort of remote and indirect, and sometimes is averaging a lot of information together, and it's hard to get the information. And then implantables, and you know, with light especially, you can get extremely detailed information into and out of neural circuits, but of course that requires some degree of invasiveness, at least to put the gene in, even if the light can get across. So it's sort of a continuum there, and we're trying to, you know, also come up with hybrid methodologies where, you know, could you take a neural implant and steer it into the brain through the bloodstream? So now you could potentially, you know, record and stimulate the brain, but never enter the brain itself. So there might be hybrid technologies that can blur the boundaries where you get, you know, the benefits of invasiveness, but the benefits of non-invasiveness as well.
Second question. I'd say that this is, you know, something where kind of the decoding efforts and some of the basic science work done in neurobiology labs it is really important, because we may have kind of low resolution, low content data, like you just averaging the activities of a lot of neurons, but you can still extract a lot of useful information from that if we just kind of understand this neural computation a little better at sort of a preclinical level, right? So it's vastly different than, say, like a Holter monitor, like, you know, monitoring, you know, heart rate. Kind of know, if you see some blip in heart rate, what's causing that and what's happening. And we don't necessarily have that information, so there's a lot of basic science that can unlock and kind of bridge the measurable that we can make and what insight we can derive from that. And then I also think that there's, with existing technology, I mean, optogenetics is a very precise tool, whether it makes sense for all indications and as therapeutic interventions is kind of a question, kind of a separate question, but I think there's a lot of progress that can be made with existing technologies as well in different ways. So for example, TMS, transcranial magnetic stimulation. Oftentimes people do, you know, one site of stimulation, but not multiple sites, but different temporal offsets and so on and so forth. So there's a lot we can do with just existing technologies.
So I will say just two comments. One is that neurons don't waste energy. So every spike counts, first of all. And the second of all, information is distributed. So even though we say certain brain regions do this, do that, but if you look at the whole brain, anywhere you stick your electrode, you monitor the activities, you see a lot of activities through the brain. So this gives hope, which means that even at the surface of the brain, some of the regions you might not intuitively think they involve in certain functions, but in fact, those spikes activities are still carrying information. It's just a matter of how you interpret. And I think there are more and more tools which using surface electrons to able to read out those tools. And using deep machine learning, so we'll be able to understand what those signals actually means. Which I think there's a lot of hope there, trying to non-invasively understand the brains in any random task you should do.
So this technology clearly presents a lot of opportunities, but Dr. Lin, your presentation reminded me of a recent movie in which an evil genius played by Samuel Jackson uses neurostimulators to make humans lash out violently, and I was thinking, as this technology is perfected, is there any concern about the bioethics of impacting human behavior, especially against their will?
That's a very good question. When I say that, typically means I don't know how to answer. yeah, so I think we're certainly not there yet. So one thing is, maybe for your comfort, unfortunately, to me, is that deep brain stimulation in the hypothalamus currently is prohibited in the United States. So this partly prevents us even trying to validate whether that potentially is possible in humans. And I showed you one side of the story, which is using optogenetics to trying to activate the regions. But the other side of the story, which I didn't get to show you, is that there are pharmacogenetic ways or other means we can suppress these areas, and then aggressive mice become very peaceful. Obviously, every technique is two-sided. It all depends on how you use it, right? You can say transgenic, okay, people think about the transgenic plants, so they think it's bad, the transgenics, they help us to produce insulin, all that. So I think it really, you know, it's we discover basic science, and we're not trying to interpret it in one way or the other. But I think what we're really trying to understand here is the basic principles, how this social behaviors, innate social behaviors, is being hardwired in the brain, how potentially those behaviors are generated from the sensory cues, motivations, and those sensory motor transformations. So a basic scientist, I guess this is one thing I haven't really think about too advancedly, but I wouldn't, you know, hold a technology or hold a discovery against those potential problems, because there will be one for any kind of discovery we will be making.
We have time for one more. Yeah?
Can you talk a little more about the genetic side of this, both the challenges in terms of, you know, a couple were alluded to in terms of targeting specific areas, or the fact that there's at least nothing in the United States that's approved for gene therapy, but also the promise that was alluded to in terms of photoreceptors, for instance, mediating transcription, and whether that would have applications outside of neurons as well?
I think there are certainly are challenges, some regulatory, some technological. I think certainly, and alluded to this, AAV technologies in Liberia and Europe is very promising. You don't see too many adverse events, and it's used widely in clinical trials in the U.S. But one technological challenge in AAV technologies is you can't deliver large genetic payloads. The size of the protein you want to express, it is limited. And also the specificity in terms of the cell type that it's expressed in is also dependent on things that are promoters that we may not have promoters for all cell types in the brain. And so that is certainly a technological challenge. In terms of, with respect to your question, outside of the nervous system, I would say that yes, and actually much of the work, one of the really exciting things that goes on, or that optogenetics has enabled, is in
please give thanks to our speakers. Mark your calendar for our next briefing. It's on July 9th, about addiction and incarceration. Thank you all for coming.